Okay, thank you so much. How I pronounce your name? That's a part of my record. I want to make sure I do it right.
Manoj Agarwal.
Manoj Agarwal?
Yeah, that's right.
Thank you. Manoj, you are an inventor, author, entrepreneur, and chief innovation officer. Yes, I have your I have your website, manojagarwal.com.
That's right, that's right.
Have you seen all of my questions?
No, but it's okay. I've seen some of them, but let's go. I mean, I generally don't read the questions. I just go with the flow.
Oh, you are good at your feet. That's what you're saying.
Yes.
Okay,
yes.
Very good. So that's good. That makes my job easy. So, and there's a timeline to every question, like no more than like a certain time. We need to finish everything in certain allocated time.
No problem.
Okay. To the point, concise will win every time.
Sounds good.
Okay. So if that's the case, let's go live. We will go live on Facebook, YouTube, and Twitter. Around 60,000 people in network. I have no idea who will be watching. However, even the one person watch, that will be a good win for us. Okay.
Yeah.
Okay. Let's go live. Greetings and welcome to Growth Hacking Secrets. I'm your host, Mohammed Siddiq from Atlanta, Georgia, and the co-author of New Success Secrets, available on Amazon. On this episode, we have a special guest, Manoj Agarwal. Manoj is an inventor, author, entrepreneur, and chief innovation officer. Please join me to give a warm welcome to our guest, Manoj Agarwal. Manoj, welcome.
Thank you so much. I'm so excited to be here. Thank you.
Thank you. Let me start with this. Where were you? What happened? Who were you surrounded with that inspired you to do what you do today?
Well, I grew up in India, and what inspired me were some business magazines. I was working in a factory, and one day I was going through these business magazines, and they triggered something in me because I saw all these accomplished people, businessmen and business women. And something triggered in me that these people look like me. They talk like me. They have everything that I have. So why can't I be like them? And that was basically that triggered me. Who were you surrounded with? I was surrounded with a lot of mentors, a lot of people who gave me their wisdom, their knowledge, and the way to look at the world, the way to figure things out, the way to get things done. So those were the people I was surrounded with. Not to say I was not surrounded with naysayers. A lot of them, most of them were naysayers, but few of them gave me what I needed to make progress in my life. And what inspired me was basically I saw my life turn around. The odds were stacked up against me. And if I could do it, then I could pass on what I have gained to others who are in my situation. And that's what inspires me every day, to help others to unlock their own potential.
What are the top three reasons why do people fail?
I think one is it's their self-doubt. They don't believe in themselves. The other one is ego. So even if they believe in, so it's like either they don't believe in themselves too much, or they believe too much, and that creates a sort of an egotistical outlook on life, and they become self-centered. And the third one is they are not very self-aware of their own strengths. So what happens is, if they want to accomplish something, they always try to follow other people and see, hey, it worked for this person, so I'm going to do that, even though they may not be very good at, whatever they are trying to pursue. A lot of people go into IT thinking that will give them a lot of progress, but they are not interested in that. A lot of people go into medical profession, a lot of people go into law and things like that. So you really need to understand what interests you, what you are good at, and then follow your own path. That is one of the main reason that people don't succeed.
What is your greatest failure story? What did you learn, and how did you recover from it?
I think my greatest failure story is my failure at my personal relationships with a lot of my family members and things like that. What I learned was, when things didn't work out between me and the relations that I'm talking about, I was always trying to find fault in myself, like what did I do wrong? But at the end of the day, what I realized was that we all have different paths. People don't understand somebody else because their thinking may not be aligned. So there is no reason to think negatively about yourself, about others. It's just that people have different way of thinking. So if somebody is not resonating with your line of thought, you don't need to think negatively about yourself or themselves. It's just you just accept it as it is, and you don't actually have to, you know, carry that burden all your life about these broken relationships.
How did you recover from it?
Relationships are things where it's a lifelong process. You have to work on it. You have to, you know, figure out where did you go wrong, and then not get bogged down by old failures, but you learn the lessons and you move on, and then you build new relationships. You know, you and I met maybe a week ago, and we had a very good connection. So it's all these learnings from the past you apply to new relationships, and then things keep improving, right?
What are your top three success secrets that others can model from?
First thing is be very, very clear on what you want. If you're not clear, but because most people say, hey, you know, I want to be successful. Okay, what does that mean? Okay, I want to earn $1 million. Okay, so if I earn $1 million, what will you do? And they don't have any answer for that. So you really need to be very, very clear on exactly what you want in life. So if you get $1 million, what do you want it for? Where do you want to spend it? What kind of experience you want to have? And then work towards that experience, not just like a wishy-washy goal that you set up for yourself. Secondly, invest in yourself, because I see a lot of people, especially in the startup world, they're looking to raise money from investors, but they don't want to invest even a dime or even an hour in their own growth or talking to people about their ideas. I cannot wrap my head around why they expect that somebody else will invest in them where they are not willing to invest in themselves. So focus on personal growth, focus on learning. And the third thing is never give up. Resilience is the key. So consistency, resilience is the key. If you give up, the failure is only when you give up. If you don't give up, that's not failure. It's basically just challenges come your way. You overcome them, you learn. And those are the lessons you need to value and keep improving yourself. But if you give up, nothing is going to materialize, right?
What motivates you within?
What motivates me, as I said earlier, you know, it's more of this learning that each one of us has humongous potential, and it lies dormant because of the way we are brought up, because of the way the society is, because of the sort of the negative sort of, sensational news cycles and social media and things like that. So unlocking that potential in human beings is what motivates me, because, I was lucky enough to find people who helped me unlock my potential. But there are billions and billions of people who are struggling. And can you imagine if we unlock even 1% of that population's potential, what kind of new discoveries, what kind of new inventions, what kind of new communities will form out of that? That's what motivates me.
What is your company's motto?
My company's motto is to unlock the power of data and AI to help other companies, other entrepreneurs, other businesses to make a huge impact in the world.
Who is your ideal client?
My ideal client is somebody who is open-minded and they understand the power of technology. They understand if people come together and apply their minds, use technology for greater good, miraculous things can happen.
how do you find your ideal client?
Well, there are multiple ways. Of course, my personal network and marketing, social media marketing, and direct outreach. These are some of the methods, but it's all mostly online. So, you know, we don't do cold calling. We don't do any of that stuff, but it's more networking, more online communication, things of that nature.
How do you engage your ideal client?
So, you know, we provide bespoke services. So it's all based on the their requirements, their where they stand. So we don't, we work with the client based on where they are. So we say, hey, you know, if you don't have this ready, then let's work on that. If you have certain steps already covered, then we will skip that and then we will go to step three. So it's all very bespoke based on our client's requirements. We work with them to accomplish their goals.
What are your well-defined products or services?
So there we offer four main services: big data consulting, big data implementation. So consulting is more like, you know, making them aware of what is possible, what is dormant in their own organization, and how to materialize it, how to recognize that. So that is a basically consulting or advice. And then many people want to actually go ahead and implement it. So we don't only provide advice, but we actually help in implementation, hardcore engineering, and bringing out results. And out of these implementation, you know, many times they need custom software implementation. So we provide that. And then lastly, there is another form of custom software development, which is IoT and embedded systems. Because what is happening in the field of technology, hardware and software is fusing together, you know, driverless cars and things like that. So all these things are hardware plus software coming together, and that creates a very, very powerful platform, very, you know, something that can change the way we live, work, and play. So these are the four services we provide to cover the entire spectrum of what is happening latest in technology world.
Why someone should buy from you?
Well, I mean, first of all, we have a tremendous track record. We have worked with some of the biggest names in the world, and we have provided tremendous value, over $500 million over the past 25 years to our clients. The other thing is, you know, we do things in a different way. We have an unconventional way of thinking. So we get things done fast, we get things done cheaper, and we are multidisciplinary, meaning we have knowledge in multiple fields, not just technology. We are experts in human psychology. We are experts in business, entrepreneurship, management, leadership. So we bring all these, you know, all these qualities, all these way of thinking, all these solutions from multiple fields, and boil it down into a very compelling solution for whatever problem you're trying to solve in your business.
How do you crush your competition?
I think we hardly have any competition because of, as I said, you know, because of the way that we work. If you go look at our website, look at my LinkedIn profile, we work with some of the top people in the world. The thing is, it seems like there should be more competitors, but it seems like most people who are in this field, big data and AI, they are very much focused on the engineering side of things, the technology side of things. They do not focus much on the human side of things, but we focus on both sides. We actually start from the human side. We understand the human behavior, and then we build technology solutions based on that. So unfortunately, most people are not in that mode of thinking. So luckily, so far, we haven't had a lot of pressure to crush the competition. People just come to us because of what we do.
How do you deliver a five-star client experience?
Yeah, I mean, that is the core of our mission, to make sure our clients are happy. So we really focus on communication. We really focus on listening to them. We do not try to, you know, strong hand them or sort of do things which are suitable for us. We do things based on what our client wants and what are the goals they are trying to accomplish. We do advise them if they are thinking in a certain way that will delay the accomplishment of that goal, But again, it's up to them to take our advice. Whatever they want to accomplish, our job is to get them that result as quickly as possible.
Okay, one second. How do you use sales proposals to close more deals?
Yeah, I mean, it's a standard practice. You know, first we have some sort of a discovery call. We understand a little bit about what they are trying to do. And then we customize our sales proposal. We share some case studies relevant to what they are trying to do. And we do regular follow-ups after we send the sales proposal to see how things are going, if there are any further questions, any further objections. If there are, then we try to address them based on past experiences, other clients who are similar to our prospect, so that it's not just our word, but they can see the evidence in the real world that, hey, you know, these things are possible, we have done this before and all that.
How do you convert your clients into your brand ambassadors?
Yeah, I mean, you know, we can take this example. You know, we connected, and then we found that we think alike, and we can do tremendous things together. So the thing is that when a client realizes that it's not just the knowledge we have, but we have the understanding, and we take the time to really listen to their requirements, that's when they connect at a deeper level. You know, it becomes more of, rather than a transaction, it becomes a relationship. So we focus on building these relationships. Once you build that relationship, and if you're delivering good service at a very good price, and you provide a huge return on your investment, then people who have good network of friends and family, they want to share. You know, we all want to share good things with our friends and family. So we create that experience for our clients such that it becomes a relationship, and they automatically, you know, whenever the need arises, they refer us to their friends and family or associates.
How do you handle rejections?
Rejections, I mean, you know, it's, I don't call it a rejection, I just call it a learning, because we understand everybody has a different way of thinking. They are at a different place in their life, in their business. So if something is not resonating, that means there is something missing in our message. There is something that we did not really pay attention to. We did not listen to them. So that rejection is a lesson for the next prospect, the next call, the next client, to not do that, or do things a little bit differently, or improve ourselves. So that's how we take rejection, to, you know, to learn from that experience and then improve ourselves.
How do you handle an angry client?
First of all, there is a reason for that anger. Again, underlying every anger, there is some miscommunication. There is some misunderstanding. So first of all, we try to understand where that miscommunication is, where that misunderstanding is. If the client is right, because we've had instances where some of our, you know, some task was not done, and we had promised that, you know, you will get this result, and then we investigate, okay, you know, what happened, where did we go wrong, was it our team, was it something, a delay that caused by the client, or whatever it is, and then we openly discuss with them that, hey, yeah, this is what happened, okay, this is our fault, or you know, we were expecting something from you and we didn't get it in time, whatever it is. So rather than sitting and discussing over what happened, let's chart out a way on the future steps, how we can fix it, how can we move forward. And in most cases, we can resolve the problem without a further altercation, because at the end of the day, even the client wants to, you know, find the solution. We don't want to waste our time just going over things of what happened, who did what wrong. It's more about finding the solution to the problem. But in some cases, if we cannot find a resolution, at the end of the day, you know, we can just say, hey, it is not working for either one of us, so let's close the deal. And in some cases, we also refund the money. You know, if the client is not happy, we don't want to take their money. So we, in some cases, if it's an insignificant amount or something like that, we haven't invested too much, we return the money.
We are about to move into lightning round. That means quick question and quick answer. Are you ready?
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yeah.
What are you grateful for today?
I'm grateful for my life and this beautiful day that has been given to me.
How do you start your day?
I start with meditation, a morning walk, and a light breakfast.
How young are you?
I'm 45.
So, Manoj, you are not 45, you are 18 years old. Rest is all experience.
yeah, that's right, that's right.
What you want to do when you grow up?
I want to travel the world. I love traveling. I love meeting new people.
What is your plan to achieve your goal?
Well, that's what I'm working on, right? Like I'm working on a company which is on the forefront of cutting edge technologies. It allows me to work with clients globally. And as soon as the travel restrictions are open, I will love to go visit my clients, work with them on their site and sort of understand their business more closely. So that's what I'm doing.
How will you feel in case you don't achieve your goal?
Well, you know, in many ways, I've already achieved my goal. So whatever comes my way, as I said earlier, I'm thankful for this day. So whatever I have experienced in my life, that's that has been a great life. You know, it has its own ups and downs, but it has been very exciting, adventurous life so far. So
how do you overcome a challenge life throws at you?
Challenges are basically opportunities. So you just look at that challenge and say, hey, how do I overcome it and grow? So once you grow, your mind expands. When then mind expands, it never shrinks. So challenges are a way to grow yourself.
What is the advice you will give to younger yourself?
Don't be afraid, everything will be okay.
Once you have a revenue generating idea, how do you convince your significant other?
I don't have, so it's a moot point.
Who is your living mentor and what's the impact?
I have many mentors. You know, one of the greatest mentors I've had is his name is Steve Sims, and he has had a tremendous impact on me. Basically, he taught me how to think about more about others, not about yourself. Be in the service of others, and that has shifted my thinking radically. And that was the impact he had on me.
I'm just curious: are you part of any mastermind, and what's the impact?
Yes. So the first many masterminds, in fact, but Steve Sims also runs a mastermind. So that has been, you know, the learning that I just shared with you that came from that mastermind itself.
Why being impactful is important to you?
You know, I see, like you mentioned mentors, I see their impact on my life, on how I have, how my thinking has shifted and how my life experience has shifted. And I want to do the same for others and, you know, unlock their potential.
What do you want to be remembered for?
I want to be remembered for an unconventional life and living life on your own terms. That's what I want to do.
How can we support you?
Basically just doing this, you know, helping others discover me and what we can do for others, and building strong networks of like-minded people, which we are already doing. So you're already helping.
We are about to wrap up. I'd like to have your few words about today's guest experience on the show. Here's my question. What would you say about your today's guest experience on the show?
A tremendous experience. Your questions are very interesting, and the way that you present, the way that you show up is very inspiring. So I'm really, really glad that I am on this show, and I'm really honored to be in your network and know you.
What would you say as a final word?
Life is beautiful, and you do not need to live by anybody else's rules. So if somebody says you cannot do it, just do not listen to that. Use that as your inspiration to go after what you really want to do.
Thank you so much, Manoj, for sharing your wisdom with us today. On the behalf of Growth Hacking Seekers community and our entire team, we really appreciate you. This is Sadiq signing off from Atlanta, Georgia. Until the next episode, all good wishes. What happened? Okay, yeah, thank you so much. I appreciate it. Very good, excellent. You are amazing, man. Okay. I like to introduce you at least one person in my network. His name is Peter. And I think I may have mentioned you on the last call too.
Yeah.
Okay. And look at your calendar. How your Monday calendar look like at 5 p.m. East Coast?
Just give me an answer. Yeah, 2 p.m. 2 p.m. PST. So that'll work. Yeah.
Yeah. Just you know that he is based in Australia. However, I have.
Sure. Yeah. So yeah, that'll work.
Okay. Thank you.
Yeah.
You should receive an email in a moment. Okay. Email is sent. Get a calendar notification. You will get on a Zoom call with Peter, and we also already have a call scheduled together anyway for another day. You know.
Yeah. Yeah, I got it. Yeah, I got it.